Who am I that you are mindful of me? That you hear me when I call. Is it true that you are thinking of me? How you love me? It's amazing. Who am I?
What's up, everybody? Good evening to you all. I'd like to thank you and welcome you to our Thursday evening Bible study, where on today we will follow up from this past Sunday's message, and we will be looking at the book of Galatians chapter 1 verses 6 through 10. Again, we will be looking at the book of Galatians. We're just going to look at a couple of short verses here, following up from this past Sunday, chapter 1. Verses 6 through 10. Before we get in our text today, and before we pray, and I will repeat this at the end of today's lesson. On tomorrow, February 11th, right in front of the church here, is our Free Food Friday, our free food distribution. We did not do it on last week because of the weather, but so far so good. It looks like we're going to have some good weather out tomorrow. So if you will meet us tomorrow at 11 a.m. right in front of the church here, the address is 5904 Marlboro Pike, District Heights, Maryland. So tomorrow we will resume our free food distribution right here in front of the church at 11 a.m. I'll say this message again at the end of today's lesson. So come on out and get some food. If you're available and you're free, we can always use more hands. So if you want to come out and help serve our community on tomorrow, you can meet us here at around 10 a.m. on tomorrow. For again, I haven't said it lately, but our mission statement here at the Lighthouse on the Pike Church is to study, serve, grow. And the serving is to serve our community and one another. And today we're going to cover the study part, hence Bible study on Thursday. We're going to look at the book of Galatians. So I will be looking at, again, chapter one of the book, Paul's letter to the Galatians, verses 6 through 10. But before we get started, let's look to the Lord in prayer. Father God, we thank you. Lord, we thank you for today, for this is the day. Today is the day that you've made. Lord, you've already preordained for us to be here on today. So whatever we may face in the world, Lord, you knew that these things would happen, and you have selected us to be here during this time. Therefore, Father, we trust you. Lord, we are not going to lean on our own understanding, but Lord, we're going to seek you in all of our ways. And on today, Father, we seek you out by way of your word, which should be our first point of contact with you. But no, Lord, our prayer on today is that you would give us guidance, that you would give us understanding, that you would give us clarity, Lord, that you would give us wisdom, that you would impart wisdom into us so that we can carry ourselves accordingly in these days. Father, it is my prayer that you would enlighten our hearts on today so that we may hear and perceive what it is that you would say to us. And then lastly, Lord, teach us to be better doers of your word and not just hearers alone. So, Lord, we thank you and we bless you. We ask these things in the name of your son, Jesus Christ. We pray. Amen. Amen. So, again, on today, we are going to be looking at the Paul's letter to the Galatians, and we're looking at chapter 1, verses 6 through 10. And I'm reading from the ESV, and the Bible reads that I am astonished that you are so quickly deserting him who called you in the grace of Christ and are turning to a different gospel. Not that there is another one, but there are some who trouble you and want to distort the gospel of Christ. But even if we or an angel from heaven should preach to you a gospel contrary to the one we preach to you, let him be accursed. As we have said before, so now I say again, if anyone is preaching to you a gospel contrary to the one you received, let him be accursed. For am I now seeking the approval of man or of God? Or am I trying to please man? If I were still trying to please man, I would not be a servant of Christ. Again, on today, we are looking at the book of Galatians, chapter 1, verses 6 through 10. Let me give you all just a quick rundown of what's happening here in Galatia. And before I do that, too, I just want to plug, you probably can go back in our archives and you can find our study on the book of Galatians back last year sometime, or maybe it was the year before. I can't remember exactly when we got to it, when we did our Bible survey, and there is a section where we looked at the whole book of Galatians, or where we surveyed Galatians as we went through the Old and the New Testament. But here's what's happening during the time in which Paul, the Apostle Paul, wrote this letter to the Galatians. We know that the Galatians was Paul's, or was scholars say that Galatians was Paul's first letter. It was Paul's first letter. It was written after his first missionary journey, somewhere around 49 AD. So we can do the math. This book is probably the first written book of the New Testament. Maybe James, the book of James probably was written before then, but this was written around 49 AD. So we're looking at some 16 years after the death and the resurrection of Christ. We also must note, too, that our Bible, the Bible itself, was not comprised yet. It had not been canonized. So there was no such thing as a New Testament, a New and an Old Testament like you and I have today. Again, at this point, the only letter that would be part of the New Testament that was written around this time, or had been already written, would have been the book of James. So this is Paul's first letter, and again, it was written after his first missionary journey. And here's what's taking place. Here's why Paul wrote this letter, or one of the reasons anyway why Paul wrote the letters, that there was some Judaizers had come and confused these new believers by insisting that in addition to placing their faith in Christ, that they also needed to keep the law. Now, when we use the word Judaizers, or if you hear it in this class or you hear it on other platforms, here's what that means. Christianity was fairly new at this time when Paul wrote this letter. So again, it's 49 AD. It's just 16 years after the death and the resurrection of Jesus Christ. So the church is still young. The church is still new. And the Apostle Paul, as we see back in the book of Acts, had at this particular point here, had met the Lord Jesus Christ. He went away for some 13 years. He met with Peter and James and John. He came back. He gave his testimony in regards to what the Lord had been doing with him as regards to teaching the gospel to the Gentiles. And Gentiles just mean non-Jews. And they gave him the right hand of fellowship and told him, and they agreed that he should go ahead and continue to preach the gospel to the Gentiles. Now, when we hear the word Judaizers, Judaizers were those who some may have believed in Christ, some did not, even though they all would have known about him. But what they were trying to do was that they would actually try to Judaize, if you will, these new believers, meaning that they would tell them that they had to follow the law as well. So if they were going to be saved and fully be in God's goodwill, that they would have to follow the law, primarily causing them to be circumcised. And this is a good portion of what Paul is defending here in this letter, which also is the theme of this letter, is that the gospel of grace, before we're saved by grace, Paul makes this argument that there's nothing that we can do in regards to works that would earn our salvation. So the main theme of Paul's letter to the church at Galatia is the gospel of grace of Jesus Christ, which brings liberty, or which brings freedom. Paul makes this argument that they are now free from the law because we're justified by faith in Jesus Christ. So there was a group of Judaizers that had confused these new believers by insisting that in addition to placing their faith in Christ, that they also needed to keep the law. Paul wrote to deal with this, again, false teaching. This is false teaching. And admonished them to stand in the freedom that has been given by Christ Jesus. Paul wrote this letter covering four things, or for four reasons anyway. A, to defend the gospel. And we see that in chapter 1, verse 9, which we're going to discuss today. To expose and condemn those false teachers, those who were now spreading this false teaching. So that's covered in today's lesson in verses 6 through 9. And also Paul talks about the false teaching again in chapter 3. He also writes to show the true purpose of the law. He writes to show why the law was needed and why it is now void under the new covenant. And then lastly, Paul writes to show that the true believer can be the perfect Christian by walking in the Spirit. And we see that in chapter 5. Again, that last one is that Paul writes to show that the true believer can perfect their walk in Christianity by walking in the Spirit. But today, I just want to look at verses 6 through 10. And again, I would encourage you all, as always, Paul's letter to Galatia is another short writing. You can read it in one sitting. Please go back and read the book in its entirety so you can grab the full scope of the letter. But in today's section, your Bible titles it that there is no other gospel. And that's probably what I want to do my best, if I haven't done so already. I want to try to drive this part home, that there is absolutely no other gospel. Now, some of you may say, well, nobody's ever telling me that there's a different gospel. And I would agree that in most cases, no one is outright saying, hey, that there's two gospels, or that there's three or four or five or six gospels. No, that's not what Paul is saying. Let's look at the text. He says that I am admonished that you are so quickly deserting him who called you in the grace of Christ, referring to God, that you're deserting God, him who called you in the grace of Christ, and are turning to a different gospel. Now, read this. I love Paul's writing because there's a hint of sarcasm here, because he says, who called you to grace, and you are turning to a different gospel. And then he says, not that there is one. So Paul is here proclaiming that there is no other gospel. So he's going to explain what he means by saying that you're turning to a different gospel, not that there is another one. But watch this. He says, but there are some who trouble you and want to distort the gospel. And that's where we are at today. That's where Paul was at in his time. Not that there is another gospel, the gospel being the good news of Jesus Christ. Now, I also want to put my finger here, because I said this on Sunday and I say it over and over and over again. And you all are probably tired already, if you know what I'm going to say, or will get tired of me, but I'm going to say it anyway, that the Bible in its entirety is the gospel. Well, Pastor G, we only have four books that's called the gospels, right? Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, because those are the texts that actually introduce to us the man Jesus here on earth. But the whole Bible itself is about him. The Old Testament revealed or conceals him, but the Old Testament speak of a time in which this Savior is going to come. I've said it the last few courses, or the last few classes anyway, that God knew that we, the world, that creation was going to be in need of a Savior, and he promises this Savior way back, or as early as Genesis 3:15. So the whole Bible, especially once we get to the story of Abraham, the narrative is being formed to show this coming of the Savior that we know as Jesus Christ, Jesus our Lord. So the whole Old Testament is moving in a direction where it's leading us to him. The gospel writings actually introduce us to him, and understanding that the time of the gospel writing was still part of the old covenant up into the part that Jesus goes on the cross. And then we get the New Testament. This technically starts at the book of Acts. And now we see the age of the church, that now Jesus has come. He's ministered here on earth. He's ministered to us by giving his life up on the cross. He's resurrected to the Lord. He's resurrected to the Father in heaven. And now he dwells inside of us today by way of the Holy Spirit. And so now we have a freedom under the new covenant that we no longer have to follow the ways of the law, for there's nothing that you and I could do that can earn this salvation. It was given freely to us, and we receive it simply by believing. So we are saved by grace, by God's grace. God gives us this grace of salvation. We're saved by grace, by through faith. So by our belief and our faith and our trust and our commitment to him. So now Paul says that I, understanding that that is the gospel, that the whole Bible itself is a story of redemption. And we see this final redemption that's going to take place in the book of Revelation, when Jesus, the second advent, where he's going to come back and he is going to rapture us, his people. And then he takes us and he redeems us and he takes us to be with the Father. So that is the gospel. That is the Bible. So now Paul says that I am, that he is astonished, that he's marveled at the fact that these Galatians, those, this new young church, had already allowed someone to come in and tell them something different than what he had taught them. Now, it is important that we note here that Paul is not teaching his own gospel. Paul is not teaching, or he has not come up with the things that he is teaching, because and we know this by one reason, because when Paul opens up his letter by saying that he has received this gospel not from man, not from any man. He had not been taught it by another man. He had not received it from another man. He received this gospel from the Lord himself. Well, he received this revelation of Jesus Christ from Jesus himself. So Paul had not taught them. This was not his own interpretation. This was not his teaching. He taught them Jesus Christ. And I want to say that is so important, because a lot of times, I don't want to say a lot of times, but I've heard it, and I know that some of you all may have possibly heard it as well, where preachers, pastors, even if some of you all are afforded the luxury to go to seminaries, where individuals like myself, I don't do this, but we're individuals that are in some type of a leadership, teacher, preacher, pastor role, will take credit for what it is that they're teaching. And they will say things like, this is my teaching. You're not going to get another teaching like this anywhere else. And we gotta be careful of that, because that could be very, very, and I'm being nice here, that's very borderline cultish in its ways. But here Paul proclaims that he himself, this is not his teaching. He says that I did not immediately consult anyone. He says, matter of fact, let's look at verse 12. Verse 11, he says, for I would have you know, brothers, that the gospel that was preached by me is not man's gospel, meaning that this gospel did not come from man. For I did not receive it from any man, nor was I taught it, but I received it through a revelation of Jesus Christ. And then he goes on to tell him that you've heard about me in Judaism and how I persecuted the church and I violently tried to destroy this, and that he was advancing far beyond his peers when it comes to Judaism. He says, but the Lord set him apart before he was born to teach this and preach this gospel amongst the Gentiles. And then he goes on just to talk about how he did not immediately consult anyone, meaning that Paul is defending the fact that no one taught him this, that this was revealed to him by Jesus Christ. And likewise, Jesus Christ was not revealed to you nor I from any man, yes, and or woman. Yes, we may have had a grandmother that read the Bible, or a parent, our mother that read the Bible to us. Some of us may have grown up in church as children. Some of us, a lot of us attend church now, hence you're watching this. And yes, someone reads the Bible, someone teaches the Bible to us. However, when it comes to the true revelation of Jesus Christ, if in fact these men and women are reading from God's word, if they're reading from God's word, they got their understanding from God's word, Jesus Christ was revealed to them. And likewise, it's being revealed to you through the word. I cannot take responsibility because I do not have the ability to reveal Jesus. This is something that he himself does. Jesus says that no man can come to the Son unless the Father draws him. And that's what we see in this text, that the gospel of the grace of Jesus Christ, it brings liberty and freedom. But here, it's the gospel and the grace of Jesus Christ that's only revealed to us by God through his word, So Paul says now, that I am like marveled at the fact that you all, not you, but those in Galatia, that they have turned away from the gospel, meaning that they have now accepted some other teachings that does not go with what Paul taught him, that in which he was revealed from Jesus Christ, that now you and I, we have the revelation of God's word. God's word reveals Jesus Christ to us. So Paul himself is still, just like he was speaking to the church at Galatia, from a certain point of view, the Apostle Paul is still speaking to us today. So it is the words on these pages, it is the power of the Holy Spirit that reveals Jesus to us. So here we are. When we understand the gospel of Jesus Christ and how you and I got saved, we didn't find him. He was never lost, but no, he came and he called us. He sought us out. He separated us. He put us apart, not because of anything that we've done, because we can never earn his salvation. We can never earn his grace. We can never earn his mercy. I don't care how long you've been in church. If you've been in church for the last 40, 50 years, that does not earn you salvation. If you remember your Bible from cover to cover, that does not earn you salvation. You can be the busiest person in your church. You can serve on every ministry and every auxiliary board. None of those things will earn you salvation. We are not saved by works. So Paul is saying here to the church at Galatia that he is marveled that they have now accepted this different gospel, meaning that you can obtain the gospel, or you can obtain favor from God by the works that you do. No. He says that there is no other gospel. But there are some who trouble you and want to distort you, or want to distort the gospel of Christ. So there were those referring to the Judaizers that was now telling them that, yeah, I know you all consider that you're saved, but you're not in favor with God yet. You don't know if you want to receive God's grace, that you need to get circumcised and follow the law. And how is that applicable to you and I today, where I just said it? Because there are some of us that would have the mindset, and some of us have been taught these things, and then some of it is picked up or we've heard other things. But we think that we can impress God by, or bribe God, or we get closer to him by the works that we do. And yes, there are works that needs to be done in order for the ministry to function. So I'm not saying that we're not to do works. What I am saying is that when it comes to salvation, that none of these things is a badge, or none of these things is a signifier, if you will, that we're saved. And there will be some that will go out and teach these type of things, that it requires us to do something. There are some that is of the belief that if you have not been baptized, that you're not saved. As if baptism is the end all be all to you being saved. Yes, we should get baptized if you can. However, baptism would be works if salvation was predicated upon it. Typically, we get baptized after we're saved, and it's a sign or a symbol of repentance where we're washed and we're identified in the death and the resurrection of Jesus Christ. But that would come after we're saved. That doesn't qualify us to be saved. So it's just little things like this. In any other some denominational beliefs or some traditions that we do in our churches, that none of these things, I need for somebody, I don't know, so I just feel that someone needs to hear this, that someone may have questioned whether or not they're truly saved based off of something that someone told them or something that they were taught or they picked up somewhere. So forgive me for those of you all who know this, but I'm after the person that may not know this, that we, you, I, me, us, we cannot earn our salvation. There's nothing, absolutely nothing, that you have done if you're coming to Christ that would disqualify you from being saved. If, in fact, the Lord Jesus is calling you and you feel this burning or this calling in your heart that now there's something in you that you may not be able to explain, that you accept Jesus Christ, that you believe that he was real, that he is real, that you believe that he is the Son of God, that you believe that he died for your sins, you believe that he resurrected. Now, I know none of it makes sense, and he sits at the Father, and it is him that gives you life. That's God calling you. There's nothing that you've done that can earn that. All you have to do is believe, the Bible says, and confess these things. And then God begins to, the Lord begins to do the work inside of you in a sense of you're compelled that you want to know more about him. You're compelled to go to church. You want to be around other like believers. That's the power of the Holy Spirit working inside of you. And that's nothing that you earn. That's nothing that you earn. You don't have to be baptized in order to be saved. You don't have to speak in tongues in order to be saved. There's no amount of money that you're going to give that's going to cover your sins or wash your sins and going to put you in right standing with God. None of those things. None of those outward. If you can do it yourself, then it's just not it. There is no other gospel. The gospel is that Jesus himself died for you. He died for me. He died for us. And that is given to us. Salvation is a free gift that's given to us. Now, it's free to us, but it cost him his life. It cost him his life. And Paul says that there are some that are out there that troubles you and distorts the gospel. And likewise, there are some that is out there amongst us. There are teachings. There are teachers. There are churches. There are schools. There are individuals. There are groups that have distorted the gospel. Remember, this is the catch-all or the end-all be-all, that the whole Bible itself is the gospel. The 66 books is the gospel. All 66 books tells us about Jesus working through and for and around and about us, even starting at Genesis chapter 1. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was God, John tells us in his gospel. But we see that in the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. And John tells us that the words that God spoke was the Word, and the Word became flesh and dwelt amongst men. The Word is Jesus Christ. So the whole Bible itself is about him. And there are many that have taught us, many of teachings that we have to do this and we have to do that. We have to follow this protocol, and we have to do these particular rituals. We have to plant a seed. We need to do all of these things that we're told that's going to bring us some type of a special favor with God. And Paul is speaking, the Spirit of Paul, the Holy Spirit is speaking to us today, just like Paul was writing to the church of Galatia, that I am astonished that you all have turned and accepted another gospel, as if there is another gospel, meaning that there are some who have gone out intentionally to distort the gospel and to trouble you. And that could be a lot of our problems, that we've listened to a lot of people who are unauthorized, to speak into our lives, and they've given us a false gospel. Anything that we hear, if it does not bring glory to the name of Jesus Christ, it's not the gospel. So Paul says this, here's what we are to do in this regard. Watch this in verse 8. But even if we, Paul is including himself, and I said this on Sunday, and I've said it plenty of times, and I'll say it again to you all today, that if you are guilty of this, Paul says that even if we or an angel from heaven should come and preach to you a gospel that is contrary to the one that we preach to you. If Paul says that if an angel himself or itself, I don't know if angels have genders. Let's start that conversation. That was a little pun. But the point is that Paul says that even if an angel comes to you from heaven, Paul says that even if he himself, so I have to say that even if I myself come to you and present to you a different gospel that is contrary to what we find here in our Bible. Now, before I go on with what should happen to me or anyone else that would do this, I need to talk to you who are listening today, because this part bears that you have to bear the responsibility of this. That how would you know if I was deceiving you with what the word says? What? Because you're going to say something to me that your spirit is troubled or something like that. I mean, the Holy Spirit does and should be able to give us some discernment when we hear something that is incorrect. But I want to focus or turn our attentions to ourselves, because this is key on something that we need to do. First and foremost, how do you know? How can you prove? How can you know for sure that someone is presenting to you a different gospel if, in fact, you have not read the gospel yourself? I'll pause. That is why I love you all. Again, here's the text. I'm going to say it to you. And you all, if you don't hear anything else that I ever said, study to show yourself approved as a workman before God that need not be ashamed, rightly dividing or rightly handling the word of truth. You and I have a responsibility that we have to study our word, or else how will we know if a false teacher is amongst us? How will we know if someone is distorting the word? Because if I distort the word, that means that I am giving you enough word. It's just blurred and there's no clarity in what it is that I'm saying, and I've now made it foggy in your mind, but it's enough of it there. But how will you know that if, in fact, you don't know the word for yourself? And then if you know the word, then you know the word, for the word became flesh and dwelt amongst men. If, in fact, you want to know Jesus, then you have to know Jesus, and he is in the word. So the first responsibility is, ladies and gentlemen, of the Most High God, is that we have to become students of our word. I know you're going to say to me, well, I know my word. I hear it all the time. And then we get in conversations with one another. Oh, I didn't know that it said that. And it doesn't mean, again, that you have to know everything that the Bible says, but you should be working at knowing everything the Bible says. And then once we understand what it says, or once we get some understanding of what it says, we need to start looking at why it says it, because this is how the Holy Spirit begins to teach us and grow us. And we grow in that spirit of discernment because we know what the word says, why it says it, who it was said to, and how we can apply it. So Paul says that even if we or an angel from heaven should preach to you a gospel contrary to the one we preach to you, let him be accursed. If anyone, I mean anyone, ever comes to you and teaches you or try to draw you away and teach you a different gospel than what this Bible says, Paul says it. Paul was inspired by the Holy Spirit to write this. God knew that we would be reading this today. So the same rule applies that if anyone presents to us a different gospel, even if an angel comes and presents to us a different gospel, the authority of the Bible says, let that person, let that individual be cursed. Who is he referring to? Those who are distorting the gospel. He's talking about false teaching. And you and I have to be aware of false teaching because false teaching takes place today just like it did back in 49 AD when Paul wrote this letter. Jesus wrote about or talked about, the gospel writers wrote about him talking about it, talked about false teaching. The Old Testament text talked about false prophets and false teachers, those who either A, went out and God had not sent them out, they were not called of God. And we have to accept the fact that those people exist today. And then secondly, those who go out and speak something that God did not say. They were also called false prophets and false teachers. And whether or not you believe in prophets today or not is irrelevant, but a false teacher or a false prophet today would be someone that goes out and speaks on behalf of God, on behalf of his word, that A, God did not send him or her, and or B, that the things that they say does not line up with what God has already left us here in these 66 books amongst these pages. Paul says that if anybody, it doesn't matter who he or she is, it doesn't matter what their titles are. He says, Paul goes so far to say that even if an angel does this, let the angel be cursed. If anyone amongst us, Paul says that even if he himself does it, then let him be cursed. I say that if I do it, let me be cursed. I told the church Sunday, I've said it before, I'll say it again, that the day that I come in here and I come before you and I began to teach and preach things that completely contradicts God's word, you all need to find you another pastor. And I'm going to have to deal, Paul says, let them be accursed. I'm going to have to deal with the consequences. I'm going to have to stand before God at some point and deal with the fact that I intentionally spoke falsely in regards to his words. Now, and I'm rambling here and I'm about to wrap up. That does not mean, because I also look back, for some of you may be experiencing this, depends on where you're at in your walk. There are things that I spoke of in the word, in regards to my knowledge of the word, based off of the information that I've had at that time. And now I look back at stuff and be like, oh my gosh, like I can't believe that I believe that. I can't believe that I've repeated that to somebody. And sometimes it was a byproduct of me regurgitating something that I had been taught and or heard. And it just really boils plain down to ignorance. But there's growth in the word. And man, I look back at some things that I grow in God's word, and I'll be like, oh man, like my belief has changed about that, or I was completely wrong about that. I am not talking about, because I just personally believe that God knows where we are in our walk. And there's a level of grace that he gives us in our learning. So we should always be learning more about him. But at any level that we are at, that we should be doing our best to study, to show ourselves approved, so we can A, not be ashamed, and also, which is I think is equally important, that we can rightly handle or defy the word of truth. So I'm not talking about you who may see yourself as that you're not as fluent in the word of God, that you want to know more, that you may have said something wrong. I'm talking about those who are intentionally amongst us, whether it's on TV, whether it's on social media, whether he or she is in our pews or on our pulpits, it doesn't matter, whoever he or she is, that there are some of us that are intentionally distorting the word. And Paul calls them false teachers. And Paul says that if anyone is preaching to you a gospel contrary to the one that you received, let he or she be accursed. Verse 10, I want to make sure that I get this because I don't think I got it on Sunday. I don't think I got to it on Sunday anyway. Verse 10 says, "For am I now seeking the approval of man or of God? Or am I trying to please man?" And this is key, because oftentimes, too, we get caught up in stuff where we don't want to offend anybody, or we want to go after whatever the popular teaching is, because we're looking for approval from man and woman, from humankind, from mankind. We're looking for approval to them, and we're trying to please them, which is why the gospel today has been distorted. Oh my gosh, it's been this, the things that we hear across these media outlets is so, a lot of things, not all things, some things that we hear across media outlets, because we just have access to so much information, is completely contrary to what the Word of God says. And then these things begin to trend, and we don't want to be offensive to our friends, our families, our networks, and we go along with it. And I said this on Sunday, one of the things how we participate in it is we even share a lot of the things, and these people become popular, and the things that they say and the antics that they do on screen becomes popular, and we are become part of the problem. We become false teachers just by way of we share false information for other people to see. If we just make this relevant to today. And so we are not seeking man's approval. The truth of the matter is the truth will offend somebody. Now, I'm not saying that we should go out and be spiritual jerks, but we do have a responsibility, like Paul here, where Paul is defending the true gospel, and you and I have to be defenders of the faith. We have to defend the true gospel in our networks, but we must know what the true gospel is in order for us to defend it. Paul is writing here in verses 6 through 9 and chapter 3, where Paul is exposing and condemning false teaching. Likewise, that's a responsibility that falls on us as the church as well. Somebody gonna say, "Well, I don't like, when something is being said around you, or something is being said to you, when we're hearing things where people are intentionally distorting the gospel, where they're trying to deceive you and others around you, those who may be of weaker in their faith, we have a responsibility, like Paul, to defend the gospel. That's where we get the word apologetics, to give a defense for what the word says. We are defenders of the faith. We are witnesses of Jesus Christ. And if we would get rid of fear and stop trying to be people pleasing, man, you would be amazed how you would open yourself up for the Lord to use you in these particular cases. Verse 10, "For am I now seeking the approval of man or of God? Or am I trying to please man?" And watch this as I close. "If I were trying to please man, I would not be a servant or a slave," is what the word actually translates of Christ. If in fact that I am still trying to please man, then I am not a servant. I am not a slave. Jesus does not have mastery over me. The individuals whom I'm trying to please have mastery over me. They are my masters. I am their slave because they rule. They have rule and authority over me, that I would rather go against God's truth in order to please them. Paul says, no, I am not seeking any man's approval. If it comes, Paul is saying that if you ever put me on the spot, well, actually, you don't even have to put me on the spot. He's always going to choose God. But for those of us, if you ever make me choose, guess what? You're going to lose. I am going to always choose God. I'm going to always choose the word. I'm going to always choose the truth. I desire to be like Paul. Well, I mean, in this regard, I am, because I'm not seeking man's approval. I'm only after the approval of God. There's only one person that can say to me, "Well done, my good and faithful servant," and that's the Lord God himself. There's no man in the history of time besides Jesus, who was God, that has the ability, the authority to say that. Paul says, I am not seeking the approval of man. This is not man's gospel. I am not trying to please man. Because if I was still trying to please man, in which one time he was doing in Judaism, if I was still trying to please man, I would not be a slave of Jesus Christ. And that's what I want to close with today, that you and I need to become fully submitted. And yes, I'm going to use the word slave because that's what the text literally says. And I can see past, our history as African-Americans as being slaves here in this country. But if I look at it from that aspect, yes, no. God has full rule and authority and reign over me. I am submitted and subjected to him, not man. And likewise, you have to be the exact same way, in the sense of that we are not here to please man. We're here to please God. And sometimes the gospel, the truth of the gospel, will offend others. But we have a responsibility to defend it, to defend the gospel. And when others speak against it, when others intentionally try to distort it, you and I have a responsibility of A, recognizing that it's not the gospel, B, defend it, and C, which is equally as important, not turn away from the truth and accept the lie. That is all that I have for you all on today. I pray that this lesson and my rambling has blessed someone today, but please, at your leisure, read the book of Galatians in its totality, and I promise you, may the Spirit of God bless you and give you greater insight in what it is that he is saying to us, the church. Before we go, remember, on tomorrow at 11 a.m., right out here from the church, 5904 Marlboro Pike, District Heights, Maryland, we will resume our free food distribution at 11 a.m. So far, the weather looks like it's going to be great, so we will be here, and we just ask that you meet us here. Come out and get some free groceries. Pick some up for your neighbors. If you are free on tomorrow and you would like to lend a hand, come on out and help us serve. Why don't you get here around 10 a.m., 10:30. That's that. I continually to thank God for you all and your continuous givings to this ministry. If this is your first time with us and you need information on how you can give, you can do so one of three ways. You can visit our website, and the address is thelighthouseonthepike.org. Again, thelighthouseonthepike.org, and click on the giving tab. Secondly, you can give by way of the Cash App. Our cash tag is $lighthouseonthepike. You can mail in your givings. Again, our address here is the Lighthouse on the Pike Church, 5904 Marlboro Pike, District Heights, Maryland, 20747. I look forward to seeing you this Sunday. We are having face-to-face services, personal service on Sunday. So we are in the sanctuary, or you can visit us right here on this platform on Sunday at 11, in-person service. That's what I was after. Or right here on this platform here at 11 o'clock. And Lord willing, right back here on next week, Thursday at 7 p.m. That is all that I have for you all. Grace and peace.